Hello all, welcome to the new video of Signals and Systems. In this video, we'll study in detail about waveguides. So the prerequisites for studying waveguides is, one should know Maxwell equations, and he should know the basic differential equations, how to solve the differential equations, and he should essentially have the basic knowledge about transmission lines. So I tried my best in covering transmission line theory in my previous videos. So before watching waveguides, my suggestion is to watch the transmission line video before watching this. So for most part of the video, we'll be dealing with mathematical equations, that is finding electric field and magnetic field inside the waveguide. So the introduction and the characteristics properties can be read elsewhere, but I'll just give the intro. What is a waveguide? So waveguide is a hollow metallic tube. Okay, it may be of either rectangular cross section or circular cross section, which is used to guide electromagnetic wave. As you can see in this diagram, I have the rectangular waveguide here. So this rectangular waveguide, what it does, it will guide the electromagnetic wave through this rectangular cross section area. So this is a hollow one, which means the electromagnetic wave which has entered here will exit from here. Okay, so at this point, one may ask why we need waveguides when we have transmission lines to propagate the electromagnetic waves from one side to the another. So let me tell you what is the issue with the transmission lines. So we all know that transmission lines can be used to transmit the electromagnetic waves of all frequencies, that is electromagnetic waves belonging to all frequencies can be transmitted through the transmission lines. But there is one issue: when the electromagnetic waves belong to this frequency range, that is 1 gigahertz to 100 gigahertz. So for information, this the frequencies of this range are called as microwave frequencies. So when the electromagnetic signals belong to this frequencies, that is when the signals are microwave signals, there will be losses in the two line transmission line system. Okay, so that is, we have transmission line to propagate the electromagnetic waves. If the frequencies belong to this range, there will be losses in the transmission line. So transmission line will be inefficient. So this will be inefficient form of system. So at that time, we need another form of system which will help us to propagate the signals without losing signal integrity. And also we need high efficiency system, that is the system should provide less loss, means the system should make sure that there is minimal loss while transmitting the signals from this one side to the another, that is source to the load, there should be minimal loss involved. So hence we use waveguides. First came transmission lines, and then since transmission lines was inefficient in transmitting some signals, so waveguides was discovered. Okay, so but there are some characteristics of waveguides. We all know that in two line lossless transmission line systems, all frequencies are allowed to propagate. Okay, if we believe this is a lossless transmission line system, then we can propagate all signals, okay, belonging to all range. Now practically there will be a losses in this 1 gigahertz to 100 gigahertz, okay. If somehow one has designed and made sure that he has compensated for the losses, then you can use the transmission line system, okay. So basically what I want to say is transmission line system is used to propagate signals which belong to all frequencies, okay, 0 to any range. However, the thing with waveguides is there exists a cutoff frequency called as FC, FC Hertz. So any signals which have frequency less than FC, okay, cannot be propagated through waveguide. However, if the signals have frequencies greater than FC, then it is allowed to propagate in the waveguide. So we'll see a lot of properties related to waveguides in some time. For the most part of the video, we'll be dealing with the mathematical equations, like what is the electric field inside the this waveguide, and what is the magnetic field inside the waveguide, and how to find out this cutoff frequencies, and also the waveguide, which you can see here. The larger inner dimension of the waveguide is called the breadth, okay. So this is the breadth of the waveguide and this is the width. This breadth and width, so this is B. So A is greater than B in the waveguide usually. So the walls of the waveguide, that is, this is the wall, the top portion, are usually made of copper alloy, and this inside surface, that is here, it is usually the thin layer of either gold or silver in order to improve the conductivity of the walls of waveguides, okay. And also if we coat the inside layer of the waveguide with either gold or silver, it will further prevent the losses which would have occurred otherwise, okay. So let's consider a rectangular waveguide which is situated in the Cartesian coordinate system, as you can see, x-axis, y-axis. So the broader dimension A is along x-axis and the smaller one, that is B, is along y-axis, and we have assumed that the wave is propagating along the direction of z direction, okay. And as you can see, we have assumed that this is filled with air, okay. So the dielectric of air we can use while solving the equations. So now we have a situation where we have a waveguide which has width B and breadth A, and we have a electromagnetic wave which is propagating through the waveguide in the z direction. So our first approach would be to write down the wave equations for this wave, okay. So let's do that. The wave equations for waves which is propagating in the z direction is given by this is mu epsilon del square Ez upon del t square, okay. And also based on the value of electric field and magnetic field along the direction of propagation of wave, we have some naming convention. So based on that, if Hz, that is magnetic field along the z direction or z direction, is 0, then these type of waves are called TM waves, that is transverse magnetic waves, okay. And also we have del square Hz equal to mu epsilon del square Hz upon del t square, Okay, and then if EZ is equal to 0, then we call it as TE waves. Okay, so you can read it as this way. In this way, for transverse magnetic waves, this is the wave equation, and we have Hz equal to 0. And for transverse electric waves, this is the wave equation, and we have Ez equal to 0. So this Ez and Hz are the components of electric and magnetic field along Z direction for TM and TE waves respectively. Okay, so these components, that is Ez and Hz, they are assumed to vary sinusoidally with respect to time and also undergo phase shift and attenuation along Z direction. So we can write the equation of Ez based on this, okay, on this assumption. This will be Eoz e raised to j omega t to e raised to minus gamma z, because this is along Z direction. So I may use Z or Z interchangeably, okay, so just cope with that. So here Eoz is the maximum value of electric field intensity along Z direction, okay, and then this omega is the angular frequency. This omega is equal to 2 pi f, where f is frequency of wave and t is the time, and also gamma is the propagation constant. This will deal with the attenuation and everything which we have assumed. So this is the Ez, okay, this is the component along Z direction for TM wave. So now next question is, we'll simplify this Ez, differentiate Ez with respect to t and with respect to z, and see what is the solution we get, and it will be of help for us in the solving the wave equation. Okay, so let's see that. So this is the equation for Ez. Ez is equal to E0z e raised to j omega t into e raised to minus gamma z. Now let's differentiate Ez with respect to t. Okay, so this will be del Ez upon del t, and since everything is constant, e raised to minus gamma z, and this will become j times omega into e raised to j omega t. So this we can rewrite it as j omega times E0z Eoz e raised to minus gamma z into e raised to j omega t, which is nothing but Ez. Okay, so on left hand side we have Ez and right hand side also we have Ez, so we can conclude that del by del t is equal to j omega. So this is a important conclusion. Let's say this is as conclusion number one. Okay, now if we further differentiate this equation, that is del Ez upon del t, we'll get del square Ez upon del t square. So this will become j omega into j omega Ez, which is minus omega square Ez. So del square upon del t square will be equal to minus omega square. Okay, so this is a very important term here. We are going to replace del or del t with j omega, and del square upon del t square with minus omega square. Okay, now next let's call it as equation 1. Now what we'll do, we'll differentiate Ez with respect to z. Okay, at that time del Ez upon del Z will become Uz into e raised to j omega t into e raised to minus gamma z. Now we need to differentiate this part, which will give us minus gamma. Okay. So this means del over del z equal to minus gamma, because we have this is nothing but Ez. Okay, so this, that means del over del z is equal to minus gamma. Now again we'll differentiate this del Ez upon del z with respect to z. Okay, at that time this will become del square Ez upon del z square. This will become minus gamma into minus gamma times Ez. This will become gamma square Ez. So there is another important conclusion here. Del square upon del z square will be equal to gamma square. Okay. So we have the operator del square upon del z square equal to gamma square. We can replace this operator with gamma square in the while solving the wave equation. Okay, similarly we can replace del over del t with j omega, and also del square upon del t square with minus omega square. Let's call this one as equation 2 and this as equation 3. Okay, so remember these three terms. It will be of use in the further equations. So let's see the wave equation now. So this is the wave equation for transverse magnetic wave, and also for TM wave Hz is equal to 0. We have discussed about this earlier. This is taken as a norm. Okay, so that's how we have defined. There is no proper reason as why we have made it named it in this manner. Okay, so now we need to solve this wave equation. So many will be having a doubt as why we need to solve the wave equation, where we are heading at this point. They may not be clear, so I want to clear why we are solving this wave equation. So before that, let me recall some things which I said earlier in the video. As I said, transmission lines can transmit frequencies of any range. The signal can be of any range. They can be transmitted over transmission lines. However, there will be losses involved if the frequency range is in the microwave frequencies. Hence we use these rectangular waveguides and circular waveguides. Okay, also I said one more point, that these waveguides have particular frequency called cutoff frequency. So they'll send signals which are above this cutoff frequencies. Okay, so if the signal contains frequencies which is less than cutoff frequency of a waveguide, the signal cannot be propagated. Okay, so now we are suppose we are given a waveguide. How to find out the cutoff frequency of a waveguide is a very important question. Okay, we know that it can transmit microwave signals, but even in that microwave range it cannot transmit all the signals belonging to the full range of microwave scale. Okay, so our task is to find out the cutoff frequency of a waveguide. So that can be only done by solving this wave equation and analyzing the dimensions of a waveguide. We can come to the conclusion about the cutoff frequencies. So based on that, practically we can send signals after knowing the cutoff frequency of a waveguide. Okay, so This waveguide chapter is full of equations, so one needs to have a lot of patience in to study this. So let's see. Okay, so this is the wave equation. Now our first task is we need to expand this delta square Ez. Okay, this delta square operator can be expanded in this way. Okay, so delta square Ez will become del square Ez over del x square plus del square Ez over del y square plus del square Ez over del z square. This will become mu epsilon, and we found out that del square upon del t square is minus omega square. Okay, so let me replace this operator with minus omega square. This will become minus mu epsilon times Ez. Okay, and also we have del square upon del z square is equal to gamma square. So let's replace this operator now. We'll get del square Ez upon del x square plus del square Ez over del y square plus gamma square Ez. Let's take this term on the left hand side, plus omega square mu epsilon Ez is equal to 0. So we get del square Ez over del x square plus del square Ez upon del y square. Now let's do gamma square plus omega square mu epsilon times Ez. We have taken Ez as common, equal to 0. So this we have rewritten the wave equation for TM wave in this manner. Okay, now at any given frequency the value of gamma, omega, mu and epsilon are all constants. Okay, hence we can say this whole term is a constant. So since we know that this term is constant, we can replace this term with another term that is a constant. Let's say it as h square. Okay, so let h square is equal to gamma square plus omega square mu epsilon. So this is a very important parameter here, try to remember this. Okay, so let's like after substituting we get del square Ez upon del x square plus del square Ez upon del y square plus h square times Ez is equal to 0. And also since we are dealing with the TM wave, remember hz is equal to 0, that is magnetic field component in the direction of propagation of wave is 0. So this is partial differential equation. Okay, so this these type of equations can be solved through separation of variables method. So those of you who are aware about separation of variable method, that is solving a partial differential equation through separation of variables method, can solve it themselves. So for those who are not aware, they can read any mathematics textbook, preferably gray one, and solve this equation. So anyway, let me show you how it is done. So in order to solve this equation, first we'll assume the solution, that is here we need to find out what is the value of Ez. Okay, so we'll assume that Ez, the solution of Ez is the product of x into y. Okay, where x is pure function of small x, this is capital X, and capital Y, this is capital Y, okay, this is pure function of small y. Okay, now replace this by Z in this equation with capital X and capital Y. So we'll get del square upon del X square upon into Z, which is X times capital Y. This will become Y into del square X capital X upon del X square. Okay, in the same way we have del square upon del Y square as capital X into del square capital Y into del Y square. Okay, so since we are dealing with only X, this del can be replaced with proper differential d. Okay, so d square of x upon dx square, this will become capital X into d square capital Y upon dy square. Okay, so now let's replace the value of del square upon del x square times Ez with capital Y into d square x upon dx square plus x into d square y capital Y upon dy square plus h square into xy equal to 0. I hope this is clear. We have assumed the solution Z is equal to capital X into capital Y, and then we have replaced this term here, and then since X is pure function of X and Y is a pure function of Y, so Y will become constant and this will become del square X upon del X square. So since X is pure function of X, we can replace the del with d square upon dx square, the derivative term. So same with the Y term here. So we can replace this equation with the help of the new modified equation. Okay, now we'll divide throughout by xy. Okay, let's do that and we'll get another equation. So let's simplify the equation further. What we shall do, we shall divide it by capital xy throughout, as I said. So we get 1 over x into d square x upon dx square plus 1 over y into d square y upon dy square plus h square is equal to 0. Okay, so now what we have got, we have got the first term, this is first term, which is pure function of small x only. Okay, and second term is pure function of small y only. So the sum of these two terms is equal to minus h square, which is a constant. Okay, so since these are independent variables, it implies that a constant plus another constant is equal to the third constant, which we already know is equal to minus h square. So let us assume that we know that it is a constant. So let's assume that the value of this differential, the first term here, 1 by x into d square x upon dx square is equal to minus b square. Okay, and then let's assume the value of this, that is 1 over capital Y into d square capital Y, d square capital Y upon dy square is equal to minus a square. So what it will become? It will become minus b square minus a square plus h square. That is I am referring to this, let's say equation, not remembering, so let's call it 4. So minus b square minus a square plus h square is equal to 0, or let's say h square is equal to a square plus b square. Okay, so since we have equated these two constants minus b square and minus a square, we get another set of differential equations. Okay, so we already know that the sum of these two is equal to a constant, so we have equated to another constant minus b square minus a square, so the sum of these two constants must be equal to the constant which we know already. Okay, this is a simple mathematics, and in doing so what we got, we got another set of equations here. So let's try to find the solution for this. These are nothing but a second order differential equations. Okay, this is I think in first year of engineering everyone would have encountered this equations. So it is very simple. Let me solve the equations, that is let me solve this differential equations of second order. So by further simplifying, we have d square x upon dx square plus b square capital X is equal to 0, and similarly we have one for y. So these are second order differential equations. Okay, so everyone must be aware of how to solve these kind of equations, so I am not going to explain that. The solution of these two equations, say 6 and 7, will be, this is pure function of x and this is pure function of y, so the capital X will be equal to, say, another constant c1 cos beta x plus c2 sin bx. Okay, not beta, b. And then we have capital Y, the solution of y, capital Y will be c3 cos ay plus c4 sin ay. So the original equation was solved through separable of variables, okay, using that method. So in that we had assumed the solution of equation, that is that particular equation, we assumed the solution to be equal to product of x comma y. So the original solution will be, now let's replace the x with this x and y with this y. Okay, so the solution, the total solution of that equation which I was referring, will become c1 cos bx plus c2 sin bx plus c3 cos ay plus c4 times sin ay. Okay, so this is a very important solution. So finally we have found the solution for the wave equation for transverse magnetic waves which are traveling through the waveguide. So we got the solution, that is the value of electric field traveling in the z direction. Okay, we got that by solving that particular wave equation. Now we are still left with four constants, that is unknown c1, c2, c3, c4. So these constants can be evaluated by using boundary conditions, okay, by using the property of electric field on the boundary conditions. We can solve the values for C2, C3 and C4. We can find out what are the values of these constants, okay. Now after this we'll get to know, we'll eventually lead up to the cutoff frequency of the waveguide, okay. So just follow the method. Later you can see this video again just for understanding, okay. So let's put the first boundary condition, that Z equal to 0 at Y equal to 0 in this equation. At that time what will happen, this term will get vanished, that is C4 sin AY will get vanished. We get C1 cos BX plus C2 sin BX into C3 equal to 0, as I have showed here, okay. So after applying first boundary condition, we have C3 is equal to 0 and our value of EZ will be equal to C1 cos BX plus C2 sin BX times C3. C3 is equal to 0, so we are left with C4 sin AY. So this is the simplified form of EZ after applying first boundary conditions. So C3 is vanished now, okay. Now let's apply the second boundary condition, that is this EZ, second boundary condition is EZ equal to 0 at X equal to 0. So now let's put X equal to 0 here, then we get EZ equal to C1 C4 sin AY, that is this term also will get vanished. So now this is not equal to 0 because this EZ equal to 0 for Y equal to 0 to B, hence sin AY cannot be equal to 0, okay. Now either C1 should be equal to 0 or C4 equal to should be equal to 0. Now C4 cannot be equal to 0 because if C4 is also equal to 0, then there would be no solution with respect to Y, okay. So that shouldn't be the case at all. So if C4 is also equal to 0, there would be no term involving Y in the EZ equation or this field, okay. So even C4 cannot be equal to 0, sin AY cannot be equal to 0. So we are only left with C1, hence C1 is equal to 0. Now we have got two constants, okay. The values are C1 equal to 0 and C3 equal to 0. Hence further our equation, that is solution of wave equation, will be further simplified. It will become C2 cos BX into C4 sin AY, or C2 C4 cos BX sin AY. So now let's put the third boundary condition, that is the value of EZ is equal to 0 for X equal to A and for Y equal to Y ranging from 0 to B, okay. So this is the third boundary condition. So by substituting X equal to A in this equation, we get EZ equal to C2 C4 sin BA into sin AY. So this is equal to 0. That is EZ equal to 0 for this X equal to A. Okay. So now this term cannot be equal to 0. This cannot be equal to 0. Hence we are left with and also C2 and C4 also cannot be equal to 0. Now we are only left with one term, that is sin BA. Okay. So sin BA should be equal to 0, because sin AY cannot be equal to 0 because Y is ranging from 0 to B. And if C2 and C4 are equal to 0, there would be no solution at all. Okay. So keeping that in mind, what happens? Sin B, the only term left is sin BA. So sin BA is equal to 0. So which means BA should be equal to multiples of pi. Okay. So multiples of pi means we can denote it by, let multiples of pi be nothing but m pi. Okay. So BA is equal to m pi, where m is equal to 0, 1, 2, etc. till infinity. So we got B is equal to m pi over A. So this is very important result. We got the value of capital B, which is equal to m pi by A. So in evaluating the constant C1 C2, we also got the value of capital B, which was unknown for us. Okay. So now let's put the fourth and final boundary condition, that is EZ is equal to 0 at Y equal to B for X varying from 0 to A. Okay. So in that case, the EZ above will become equal to 0 C2 C4 sin BX into sin A times small b. Now again, sin BX cannot be equal to 0, and C2 C4 also cannot be equal to 0, because if these are equal to 0, there would be no solution at all. So the only term left is sin AB, which should be equal to 0 to satisfy the equation here. That is the to satisfy the boundary condition. So if sin AB equal to 0, AB should be equal to multiples of pi. So let's represent this by n pi, where n is equal to 0, 1, 2 till infinity. So now we got the value of capital A, which is n pi over A. Oh, sorry, n pi over small b. So after applying fourth boundary condition, we also got the value of capital A. Now we are left with another two constants, C2 and C4. However, these constants cannot be evaluated because all the boundary conditions are over. So we can, this equation, or I must say this solution of the wave equation, that is EZ, cannot be evaluated further than this equation. Okay, cannot be simplified further. So this is the solution of wave equation in the waveguide for TM wave. Okay. So EZ is equal to C2 C4 sin m pi by A into X into sin n pi by B into Y. This is the value of electric field in the direction of propagation of wave in a waveguide. But we are not interested really in this part. So we are interested in finding out the cutoff frequency. So let's concentrate on that part. So earlier in the video, we have found out that h square is equal to a square plus b square. That is, we had assumed that this constant h square is sum of two constants a square plus b square. As you saw, in solving the differential equation and applying the boundary conditions, etc., we finally reached a point where we got the value of capital A and capital B. So, since we have got the value of capital A and capital B, let's substitute those values here. So, those like we know that A is equal to n pi by B, and B is equal to m pi by small a, and also we know that h square is equal to gamma square plus omega square mu epsilon. So at what we had suggested was, or we knew that at particular frequency this term is constant, hence h square is also a constant because we have just equated it to gamma square plus omega square mu epsilon. So let's substitute here the values here. We get gamma square plus omega square mu epsilon equal to a will be equal to n pi b whole square and b equal to m pi by a whole square. So I'll just rewrite it as b square plus a square. This will become m pi by a whole square plus n pi by b whole square. Okay. So I want just the value of gamma. So that time this will become m pi by a whole square plus n pi by b whole square minus omega square mu epsilon. Okay, then if you want gamma, this will be m pi by a whole square. So this is just a simple mathematics, and there are, as you saw, there are a lot of equations involved in this waveguide chapter. So this is the value of gamma. So gamma is nothing but alpha plus j beta. We get this term. So this is very important. Okay, so after solving all those equations, we have finally found out the value of gamma, which is equal to root of m pi by a whole square plus n pi by b whole square minus omega square mu epsilon. Okay, so this is the value of gamma in a rectangular waveguide for a transverse magnetic wave. Now this is just an equation, so we need to understand the importance of this equation. So what it is trying to convey to us, okay, this is very important in physics, that is to understand the equation and what it really means. So that is very important part. So just assume, what if the value of omega square mu epsilon is less than the sum of this? At that time what happens? Say this is this will become a positive value, and then the gamma will also become positive value. Okay, this will be positive, gamma is equal to positive. Now if gamma becomes positive, what that means? So gamma is nothing but the sum of alpha plus j beta. Okay, if this is equal to positive, which means there is no imaginary term and there is only positive term, which is nothing but attenuation factor. So if omega square mu epsilon is less than m pi by a whole square plus n pi by b whole square. That means the value will be gamma will be positive, which means it will be having a particular attenuation factor, which means the wave which is propagating in a waveguide will be attenuated and it cannot be, so the signal integrity will not remain till it reach to the destiny. Okay, once it reaches the end point, it won't be the same signal anymore, so the signal integrity will be lost and the waveguide would have been attenuated or destroyed in the middle. Okay, so that is the significance of this. And also if omega square mu epsilon is greater than this part, then gamma will be imaginary, which means wave will be propagated. So it is because of this value gamma that I have said that waveguide, that is rectangular and circular waveguides, they will allow signals with frequency greater than fc, because if the frequency of the signal is less than fc, then the signal which is passing through the waveguide will be attenuated. That is, the signal which is passing through this waveguide from here will get destroyed at this point. It won't reach till the end. Okay, so that's why the cutoff frequency is mentioned for a waveguide. If you don't send the signal above that cutoff frequency for a waveguide, since A and B are the dimensions of a waveguide, they pretty much play the role in deciding the cutoff frequency FC. So we are just one step away from finding out the cutoff frequency. So this is the clear now as why waveguides will allow only certain signals even in microwave range. It cannot allow all the signals in the microwave range because of this important factor called as gamma. So this whole equation will determine which signal with what particular frequency will be transmitted or it will not be transmitted. Okay, so we found out that all lower frequencies are attenuated. And all higher frequencies are propagated in a waveguide. Okay, so there must exist a frequency in the middle where the propagation must begin. Okay, so that frequency is called as cutoff frequency. Okay, so at cutoff frequency we have gamma is equal to 0 and f is equal to fc. Okay, so the gamma square will become m pi by a whole square. Plus n pi by b whole square minus omega square mu epsilon. Okay, so at cutoff frequency we have gamma is equal to 0, that is no propagation. Gamma equal to 0 means no propagation, that is the cutoff, that is the middle. Okay, it is the middle level, no propagation, this is the cutoff. So Since this gamma equal to 0, this whole term will be equal to 0. So we have omega c square mu epsilon. I'll write it down in the next page. So omega c square mu epsilon is equal to m pi by a whole square plus n pi by b whole square. We know that omega is equal to 2 pi f. So at cutoff frequency, omega c, f will be equal to fc. So substituting here, we get, I'll do it here in this way. So I'll first push mu epsilon in this right hand side, mu epsilon into m pi by a whole square plus n pi by b into whole square. Okay, so if you need omega c, which is 1 upon mu epsilon, square root of m pi by a whole square plus n pi by b whole square, and also omega c is equal to 2 pi fc. We'll substitute the value here, so that will become 2 pi fc, and if you send 2 pi here, we have final value fc, which is equal to 1 over 2 pi mu epsilon. Root of m pi by a whole square plus n pi by b whole square. So this is the final equation. Okay, and also sum write 1 over mu epsilon as c, and this pi will get cancelled. So that is the final one. So let's do that as well. This is a bit complicated and it will be tough to remember. So since the speed of light c is equal to 1 over root mu naught epsilon naught, we will try to use this in here. Okay, since we are dealing with dielectric as air as dielectric, we get epsilon equal to epsilon naught epsilon r is equal to 1, so epsilon equal to epsilon naught and mu is equal to mu naught. Okay, this is nothing but mu naught and epsilon naught. So for air as dielectric, what we have got, this pi will get cancelled, you take common and it will become 1 over 2 root mu naught epsilon naught into m by a whole square plus n by b whole square. Okay, so this is nothing but c is equal to 1 over root mu naught epsilon naught, because we are dealing with air as dielectric in this waveguide. So the final equation will be c over 2 root of m by a whole square plus n by b whole square. So this is the cutoff frequency of waveguide, cutoff frequency of rectangular waveguide. So where A and B are breadth and width of rectangular waveguide, and C is the speed of light. Okay, so this is for TM mode, where M and N are modes of waveguides. So we'll be talking about the modes of waveguide in the next video lecture, because this is already a very big lecture, maybe of around 40 to 1 hour, I'm not sure. So this is the final cutoff frequency equation which I was talking about in the beginning of the video. So in the next video we'll talk about the wavelength, that is we have speed of light and we have got frequency, so it is easy to find out the cutoff wavelength. And then we'll talk about the mode which I mentioned here, because we already know what is the value of A, what is the value of B, and what is the value of C. However, we are not sure what is the value of M and N. We only know that the value of M and N can take between 0 to 1 till infinity. Okay, so that all we know by this lecture. So let's see what are those, and we'll solve some equations. Okay, so it took a really long time to write down all the equations. So hopefully those who are watching can go back and watch any equations which didn't make any sense. And if you have any doubts still, you can use the comment section. Okay, and please subscribe to our channel, guys. We are taking a lot of effort in making these lecture videos so that it will help the electronic fraternity, not only electronics but electronics and electrical engineering fraternity. So hopefully it will help you guys to understand the subject better and appreciate the work done in the field of electricity and magnetism. So thank you. We'll come back with the next video lecture on transmission lines and waveguides. It will be on modes of waveguides. Okay, so thank you.